pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States.
Okay, first thing is to approve the agenda. The only thing in the consent agenda, we're going to pull out the approval for the liquor license on JT's Hideaway, and we are going to have a separate discussion on that to make sure that that gets handled properly. But it's still letter E in number 11 is just going to be kind of pulled out and handled on its own. Anything else? Not, I guess I'll make a motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
Second by Dave Brugic. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Okay, agenda is approved. First thing on the agenda is we have a stranger. Oh, Chris. Welcome back.
Thank you.
We were talking before the meeting. I said, you know, we don't have a street project, and you don't see Chris unless he needs something, you know? But.
How to respond.
Yeah, well, we're glad you decided to come and visit us.
Computer's beeping at me. Uh-oh, what's going on here? Did I hit something? What did I do?
It comes again.
No, it stopped. Okay, well, Mayor, members of the City Council,
when Patrick comes in, we'll say, okay, adjournment.
Before you is consideration of an agenda for, or consideration for a resolution for making some revisions to the municipal state aid system. You may recall we did something very similar to this last year. And we're actually proposing to make some more changes this year. Part of what happened is, if you recall, the city accepted Jillian Street down in the southeast part of the city as a public road. When that's brought into the city system, the way the formula works is 20% of all your mileage can be dedicated to state aid as a state aid street. Well, last year we were just shy. We needed like another tenth of a mile to do what I really wanted to do. We brought that in, that brought us over the threshold, and decided to make some changes. If you look at the map here, there was some, if you recall, I mentioned that the state aid system had made some rules changes about 3 years ago. And the old system that had been there since the 1950s really favored roads that were unimproved or even non-existent, because they had more need, it cost more to bring them into a standard. And so it was always more favorable to try to put some of your mileage on areas that didn't exist or hadn't been built yet. And so we had some mileage over on Naylor and on 6th Street Northwest that currently doesn't exist. Naylor's low mileage, obviously gravel road, would have a lot of need under the old system. Rules got revised about 3 years ago, and it makes more sense for us to put it on the logical spots, and that's what I call our collector system, our grid system, which is what we did last year. Last year we added the stretch of Tulipski, a little bit of 3rd Street, and what I'm proposing, as you can see in the map here, is to revoke this mileage over here, Naylor, 6th Street Northwest. There's a little chunk of 1st Avenue over here on the just west of City Hall that we never used any state aid funds for when we improved that, and would like to place that mileage over on 3rd Street, an extra block here, actually shift this block of 7th over to Lexington, higher volume road. This stretch of 1st Street Northwest, and this segment of Chalupski over north of Main Street, and then lastly this segment of Lexington and Heritage Trail up to 12th Avenue. Again, this is putting our mileage now. We're sitting pretty good at this point. This system makes more sense. Again, under the new rules, all the numbers worked out in terms of available mileage, and so this is certainly what my recommendations are, is revoke those segments I'm referring to in the resolution and to add in the new ones. So questions or?
So bottom line, the changes result in what?
Well, the bottom line changes is it should result in some additional revenue beginning next year. In our allocation for January, we should see an increase in what we would normally have gotten if had we not made any changes. Now, will we see more funds? I don't know. That has to do with, again, how much gas tax is available and how many cities are in the system and what all gets distributed. But based on this calculation, we will receive more money with designating them as we're proposing than if we just left them as they are today.
Okay. Any questions for Chris?
I do have one. A lot of these are newer roads. Was in your evaluation, did you look at the roads that would be for 2023 and those when we start projects again? Did any of those fit criteria?
Well, there's certain criteria of where you can designate state aid roads. They has to, the beginning and terminus has to be either on a state aid road, trunk highway, or county road. There is a segment of First Street Northwest or Northeast that is in the 2022-2023-2024 area. But beyond that, it's kind of limited on how much coverage we can have. Again, we do want to look at a grid, and we do want to look at the higher volume roads. And again, under the new needs formula or whatever, it doesn't matter if it's a brand new street or an old street. Under the old system, you wanted it on the old deteriorated street. This is where you really wanted to designate your mileage, because once the street was improved, it really earned very little need at that time, but not anymore. Now it's really based on ADT traffic volumes and things like that.
I figured you looked at it. I just had to ask to make sure.
No, great question, though.
Any other question? If not, I guess I'll look for a motion to approve the proposed changes to our state aid roads.
So moved. Second.
Okay, I got a motion by Sean Ryan, second by Dave Brugic. Any other comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Okay, passes 5-0. I assume you're taking the next one?
Yes, Chris? Mayor. Thank you. You'll recall that in December, the City Council authorized us to submit an application, grant application to MnDOT. It's what they call their STP or Small Urban Funds grant program. And it's part of what they call the Area Transportation Partnership. We wanted to apply for those funds for to assist with some of the financing for Main Street in 2020. So that application was submitted as you approved in December. There were five applications that were actually submitted to MnDOT for that funding, and New Prague, Mankato, Worthington, St. Peter, and North Mankato all requested grant funding through that program. Glenn and I did attend a meeting on February 18th to go visit with MnDOT to present the project in more detail, and there's basically presented to a subcommittee of the ATP Area Transportation Partnership, and then they go to a overall meeting through the larger group to make recommendations to where to award those funds. The short of it is, I was notified last week that New Prague will be eligible to receive $1.5 million in the STP Small Urban Cities Grant Program. These funds should be, they have to be utilized on the trunk highway, and it'll be items such as city will be required to pay some of the costs for the parking, they'll be required, obviously. MNDOT will fund a certain amount of landscaping and aesthetic features, but only to a certain amount. So that'll help the city fund above and beyond that. It's what they basically say. It has to be federal eligible, state aid eligible expenses, but it'd be expenses above and beyond what MnDOT will cover through their cost participation policy. We're going to know a little bit more in detail on that. Mike and I have a meeting scheduled for later in the week with MnDOT to review a preliminary draft of that, but that's all still real early now. But right now we got some additional funds that we'll be able to work with, and the city will be able to work with in the entire funding process. So good news.
Awesome. Congratulations. Was that the maximum we could get?
That's what we requested.
Okay.
As it turned out, we found out they had ended up with about 1.7 available, and I think that 200,000 got handed off to somebody else. So.
Okay. Well, congratulations. Thank you.
Oh, likewise.
Glenn, thank you.
Congratulations.
Does it look like we'll get all of that 1.5, or is there a chance they cut that back?
No, I don't. They would not cut it back unless we basically show that we don't need it.
Okay.
And I'm kind of would be surprised to see that we won't need it. So that's a significant project, certainly.
Yep. Yeah. Well, thank you. You can show up anytime if you have news like that. That's what I like to hear. Next on the agenda, Glenn, I assume you're taking the purchase of the lawnmower?
I am. In front of you, you have a memo requesting the purchase of a new zero-turn lawnmower for the Parks Department. It'd be a 2016, 60-inch mower, 25 horse. It'd be replacing a current mower, a 2009 Cub Cadet that we have. It's got 2,300 hours on it. We budgeted $13,000 in the Parks Department budget, looked at three different manufacturers, demoed three of them last fall, and then got prices this year, state contract pricing. After looking at all the specifications, and we do have some Toros in our fleet, being the golf course and in the Parks Department, and they've proven to be pretty good mowers. So the recommendation by staff is that the City Council approved the purchase of the 2016 Toro 7000 Series zero-turn mower from MTI Distributing for $11,405.96. So if anybody's got any questions, I can try to answer them.
So, Glenn, is it a stand behind? Do you stand on this one, or do you ride it?
No, you ride it.
You do?
Yep.
Well, the picture makes it kind of look like you stand on it, like the commercial one. So.
I couldn't find a better picture. I just didn't want to print out or copy nice.
So your staff wouldn't be happy. I'll make a motion to accept for the purchase of this Toro.
Okay. Yeah.
I'll second.
You got a motion by Jenna Tooman, second by Sean Ryan. Any other comments or questions? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Okay. Thank you, Glenn.
Thank you.
Make sure you put the snowplow on it for Wednesday, will you?
Yeah, that's what they're saying, aren't they?
Ken, I assume you're going to take the citywide cleanup?
I will. For the 2016 citywide cleanup event, we did receive notification from Scott County in the letters in the packet that they have made available $1,080 for our local cleanup day event that helps us offset our local costs. This is the same amount of money that we were awarded through this grant in 2015. We have, as we have the past few years, estimated our staff costs to be roughly $2,500. We might be a little under that this year. One change I did want to point out, after talking to Glenn for the program last year, the city had been kind of doing a citywide canvassing for tree trimmings. And I think you said you only had a handful of sites last year that did that. So now we're asking people contact us, and we'll specifically drive out to their home site to pick up those tree trimmings so we don't waste all day looking for them. So that's the only change, and that might bring our total cost down a little bit, which is estimated at about $2,500, including printing the flyers. So what we do need to enter into, and we do this every year because we don't get the recycling program agreement usually until after the event or very close to the event, is I've put last year's example of our agreement with the with Scott County, and we would look to enter into this agreement again with them for the 2016 year. And we'll obviously do the event without the money anyway at this point, because we've already advertised for it. But it just says that we'll carry out our program and they will reimburse us after we show we have expended funds. So,
okay. Any questions for Ken?
Have we looked at, and I don't know if people want it or request it, having a shredding place for residents that day?
I've not actually heard that as a request from residents. I don't know if any other staff has, but not that I've heard directly, no.
Maybe possibly next year we could see if it, what it costs, if it's
possible.
Yep, we
could look into that.
See if there's anyone interested.
I would have been. I just spent 3 hours in my basement shredding, so I would have taken you up on it. But yeah, that would be actually a nice service to offer.
Okay. Any other comments? If not, I guess I'll look for a motion to approve the recycling program agreement with Scott County.
So moved.
I'll second that. So you got a motion by Dave Bruzek, second by Chuck Nicolai. If there's any other comments? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Okay. Passes 5-0. Moving right along. Looks like number five, Mike, this is the second reading. I know you must have had Scott take a look at it.
Yes, he did, as I make mention in my memo, that when you take a look at previously, as I mentioned to you in the paragraphs D, D1, D2, and then renumbering from up to paragraph E, is we made slight changes. If you remember, I was suggesting that we take a look at reformatting for readability and understanding with D, D1, and D2. They were separate individual paragraphs, D, E, and F. We just reformatted, and if you look at the end of D, as far as the calculation is calculated as follows, which is number one, and then we combined into the second part of that the provision, if you remember, if anybody had 1, 2, or 3 months where they had zero consumption, we incorporated both of those individual statements into that one paragraph and then renumbered what was already in existence in number two. So we improved that from a reformatting and readability. You were concerned that it might change. Scott was just okay with that that change. So we made no other material changes in the ordinance. And so it is as we went through and reviewed with you at the last meeting.
Okay. Any questions? If not, I guess I'll make a motion to approve the second reading of the ordinance, a change in the ordinance of sewer rates.
Second.
Second by Sean Ryan. Do we have to do this by roll call, Mike? Or?
Yeah.
Okay. Being it's a second reading of the road, we're going to do a roll call. Councilperson Ryan?
Aye.
Councilperson Bruzek?
Aye.
Councilperson Jurek?
Nay.
Councilperson Tuma? Mayor Nicolai? Aye. Okay, passes 4-1. Then it'll get published and should be?
Next week it'll be published.
Then ready to go?
Yep.
Awesome. Thank the staff, Mike, and yourself, and all that hard work to get that thing ironed out. Thank you. At the last meeting, we did talk. We kind of talked about the need to maybe have a workshop to discuss the athletic facilities and other facilities within the city. So Mike has kind of put up a few days that we can maybe mark our calendar and see if we can come in agreement and meet on that. Ken, did you get books ready for?
I did not get them ready. I did find the book.
Okay.
So we can make a copy of it fairly quickly.
Okay. Amy, you need a book, and Jenna needs a book. You guys still have yours?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I found mine the other day.
Two? Okay.
Yep. Thank you. So, what works for everyone?
They all work for me so far, Mike.
I would say all of them work for me. Wednesday would be my last choice, if that makes it, but it would work for me.
I'm pretty flexible, so. How about you, Amy?
Beginning of the month is better for me, so maybe the 11th. I could make it work for any of them, but I'd prefer probably
the 11th.
When's home opener? I got.
Well, it's all there. About you, isn't it?
No, it's a work day for me though. So. And the 25th is Mike and I and Ken have the joint powers meeting with the school district on the 25th. So it, Tuesday the 26th, or and Jenna said Wednesday doesn't work for us.
So. You know, it does for me, oh, it but does? It just isn't my top. So
the 26th, I could make work.
26th? Okay.
Okay.
26th. That should give plenty of time to get Ken to get you the books, and you guys can have. You'll be ready for the test that we'll give to you on the 26th. So.
What time do you want to start? 5:30?
Does that work for everyone?
Or is it too early? Better?
Amy, does that work for you, or do you want to go 6?
6 would be better.
Okay. 6 o'clock on the...
And you want dinner or not?
We want dinner or not.
Your choice. Your call.
Doesn't matter to me.
I don't
yeah.
know.
Okay.
Just maybe have some refreshments, or if it's going to be a couple hours, just to, you know, like a 12-pack of beer or something. Oh, yes, Glenn's going to show up for the meeting now.
That'll be at City Hall.
Yes.
Yeah. Chamber room?
Upstairs.
Yep. Okay. Okay, good. Thank you. That was painless. Next one. Mike, I think you're just kind of giving us an update.
Yeah, just a brief update is that I had followed up based on the school board taking action on the award of bids, I believe it was a week ago tonight, on March 14th. And what I did is, since we didn't see the details of the bids or any of the breakdowns, it was my understanding, and you can see I asked the superintendent for clarification of just exactly what will we owe as part of the project, that apparently they bid the swimming pool and the CEC and all that into one, so it wasn't easily able to be broken out differently or anything. And then we had the question on the feature with the outdoor plaza area, and his confirmation to me, as you can see in here, is for all of those elements it will be $1.1 million for the city to participate in. So as you can see, the materials that we provided you on the last page that we had is we had the 1.1 plus $53,000 for the outdoor plaza, and his conveyance to you is that all of that is included in the 1.1. And we could take a look at is that we will have are still responsible for the floatable play elements and the water basketball and the volleyball and the aqua climbing wall. And so in talking with Ken, as he's taken a look at that, he seems to think we should be able to afford those elements within those remaining dollars. So the dollar allocation that you had that we had made available was the 1.1 plus the 53.1. And so the school, their conveyance to us is to use the 1.1 and then use the other remaining pieces to augment the purchase of the equipment when, as time gets closer. So
okay.
That was just looking for confirmation that we weren't going to get surprised with some higher number or something different than we were expecting. And so as you can see, his memo is what we received in response to that.
And I think Tim today said April 1st. For groundbreaking on the pool.
Wow. They're
so
moving.
They're moving. He wants to make sure that they have it in, have it ready up and going for the summer of 17 for their community ed lessons and things like that, and then for sure to, for their sporting swim team the fall of 17.
But I don't know where they're going to do the groundbreaking, but I know it's the combination CEC and the swimming pool, so I'll be in conversation with him to see if, because of our participation in the project, whether he extends an invite to all of you if you want to be there for the pool portion, assuming they're going to do something down in the vicinity of the pool, but I don't know where yet.
Okay.
Mike, what have we decided about the plaza? Are we going to include that?
I'm sorry?
What did we decide about the plaza? How are we going
originally, to, our intent was going to be acquired to them, it was an ad alternate. they incorporated it into the
plan.
They
did.
And they said the reason being is that in the incorporation of the footings and the wall and the doors and some other things, it really didn't lend itself well to trying to bid as an ad alternate. So they included it in it, and it's in the 1.1. So he seems to think it's going to be a nice piece, as I think we thought originally, that it would be a nice element to have off the that west wing of the pool area there in the summer months. And so it will be included from the onset.
Okay. Good. Any other questions or comments, Mike, regarding the update? Okay, next on the agenda. Mike, I assume you're taking
this one is just kind of more informational as well, is that last Wednesday, council members Tuma, Jurek, and Ryan attended with myself the invite from the Coalition of Greater Minnesota Cities on their Legislative Action Day up in St. Paul. We also met with Senator Dahl and Representative Vogel. The invite, if you recall, came from the mayor of Le Sueur, who is the president of the coalition this year. I think there were a couple of you that asked, you know, what is the cost of being a member of the coalition? They were more than happy to provide that information. Our attendance last week at both the reception and the event was at no cost to the city. They did identify in the materials that I provided to you a breakdown they provide for a four-year phase-in as it relates to memberships. That's back on page 2. I try to provide as background, information to the effect that the membership in our area, the closest cities, obviously are Waseca, Mankato, Owatonna, St. Peter, and Le Sueur. Their primary focus, their legislative advocacy, while it's significantly different from the league in the sense, is the league provides service to, I believe it's over 800 member cities. The coalition is, I think, in the vicinity of about 80, and that's just for the outstate greater Minnesota cities. But where the league covers a lot of different program areas and elements and issues, the coalition is focused specifically in the areas of local government aid, property tax relief, annexation and land use, economic development, the environment, transportation, and then labor and employee relations, and that's it. So it's just those specific focused areas. As I told you that I came from a city that was a member, even after going back and rekindling, I think the interaction a little bit, and you can see their advocacy, what they do, that they have very strong information and I believe a fairly great reputation within the legislative process, that there's a number of things when you look at our participation in LGA. Not a lot of annexation and land use issues that we've had here historically. Economic development has been in more of the general programs and the funding and the redevelopment grant programs. The environment, the things that get involved with, largely has to do with the environmental issues and MPCA as it relates to wastewater treatment plants, which we obviously have. Most of the metro area is provided through Met Council program, so they don't have to worry about that. And then obviously transportation on outstate transportation issues. And then in the labor, it's personnel and the collective bargaining front that they provide a lot of assistance. As an inducement to try to get people to join, as you can see on that page 2, their first year dues are about just under 3,000, and then it goes to just under 6, just under 9. And the full membership is $11,888. I'm not necessarily recommending tonight that you need to jump in and join, but I wanted to make sure I provided as a follow-up the information to allow you to digest, take a look at it, and see whether you think that's of benefit, that, you know, whether we join or not, we still benefit, I think, from a lot of their advocacy. And the side of us that is on the rural side of the Scott County, Le Sueur County line, I think there's some benefit in the process. We have a membership in the League of Minnesota Cities that I think does services quite well from all of the staff I know from all fronts, training, our assurance program, and education and other things in it. So whether this is absolutely needed or not is probably debatable, but I wanted to still follow up, get you the information, and give you time to think about it. And if we want to, we can certainly bring them out for They offered to provide an informational presentation to you if you wanted to, or we could take a look at it in the budgetary process. So there's nothing absolutely requiring us to join right now, but I just wanted to do the follow-up and the follow-through just to so you have the information.
What's our annual fees for the league?
I want to say it's about 9,000, give or take, somewhere in that range, 9,500.
Mike, would it be appropriate to join it for a year or two and then drop out?
You can, to see whether you think you get enough benefit, and that's why, quite frankly, they have the membership access program the way it is that it allows you to try it on, see if it fits, see if it does what you want it to do, and if it doesn't, you can discontinue. So there is no obligation that just because you join doesn't automatically require you to continue to stay in, and that's why they have the phase-in program.
Yeah.
So that there's certainly is an option.
There's not an issue being part of both organizations.
No.
There.
Many of the cities are dual. There is another separate Metropolitan Association membership program, kind of like the Coalition, only services the outstate cities. There is another metro one for the Twin Cities that we don't participate in as well.
Thank you for the information, Mike. I think I personally think we should just think about it and check with staff to see if they think it would be beneficial, if there's anything that they would.
Maybe we can discuss it on the budget process if we think it's something, maybe like today's point, if we want to try for a year or 2 years, you know, the investment isn't too huge.
I'd like to see their presentation first before we put any dollars to it, right? So.
Sure.
Would you like that in the coming weeks, just so you have the benefit of that as follow-up to where we're at right now, just to see that, or do you want that scheduled later in the year?
Well, I think any time before the budget process starts. I mean, I don't know if we need to do it this summer yet. We could even wait till September.
Well, let me take a look at either May or June and see what works for them.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, well, I just want to make sure I followed up and got the information. I think that.
Thank you. Mike, are you taking the next one?
I'll bring it to a stage that I can set the discussion that, as you recall, you'd asked us to bring this topic back tonight to take a look at possible further discussion, either on a possible golf discount or some adjustment to the program that previously was provided in the form of a golf membership. The city, under the personnel policy, used to provide that as a full-time benefit to full-time employees. I think we had all of, I believe it was 10, 11, about 12 employees, I think, that participated in that, some at various levels. Some had single memberships. Others ended up buying a family membership and paying the difference between the single and the family. And this came up for discussion in 2014, and it was ultimately an action taken by the council on December 1 of 2014 on a 5-0 vote to discontinue to provide the golf membership benefit to all full-time employees and to subsequently negotiate its removal from the police union contract, which we subsequently did. The topics or some of the issues I tried to identify in there as to, you know, how many people use the benefit? Was it an appropriate public expense? Was the benefit taxable? It had not been. Did the employees need the benefit? Was the golf course being deprived of needed membership revenues as the city did not pay for the golf memberships? Who should have been covered or not covered under the policy? And were there any health-related benefits by encouraging the employees to get out and to play that golf? Currently, we have three of the individuals on the council that voted for that decision. So if you're looking for further clarification or explanation, they can probably provide it better than what I have. I think I provided to you the minutes from that action back in December. I think one of the other members that was on the council's in the audience as well here this evening. So we've got four out of the five that were involved and participating in that are here tonight. And so I provided also the breakdown of the information of what we have for the 16 golf memberships. And so We really didn't develop an opinion. Patty left, and we really didn't have a lot of time to go out and solicit other golf courses. I did get a listing that I got from the legislative auditor's office of the other public courses, so we certainly can make an attempt to do further research, depending upon where the discussion goes tonight, to see what, if any, other benefits are being provided from some of those other cities that have public golf courses. But we did not have time to get that all done for tonight's meeting. So depending on where you go and what you want to look at, we can do further research for you.
Okay. Any comments?
I'll start, since I was the one that asked to have it go on the agenda. I think it was you and I that talked about, you know, bringing this back. I didn't have a lot of history on it or where it went. I was taken back from the option for the staff. It just seems like a reasonable amenity to offer the staff at really no cost to the city for making it available. I think a lot of workplaces provide some kind of a wellness and exercise opportunity to get out or use amenities. I think it does a lot for staff to know, like Mike said, not a lot of people are using it, but it's one thing to have it there. And I've been a fan of getting people outdoors and to recreate and to try something, especially when it doesn't cost the city any additional money for it. And I think morale goes up. I think people feel valued. I think it creates a stronger workplace, work team. And so those are my thoughts on it. Yeah, and so I'd be curious to know from the other council members maybe where their feelings on it. And I would recommend, I'd be supportive of entertaining an idea of bringing it back to offer it for our staff.
As a free thing, or
I would offer it as free. I think you could do it a couple of different ways. You could either have the membership, or you could just not have a membership at a certain value. You could just allow them to play, get tee times on certain times of the day for free. So you're not getting a membership at $800, but you're coming in and you have a recreation pass or a use pass that allows an employee to come in and golf for free. So it's not such a value versus it's an opportunity to play. Sometimes you can restrict it a little bit on when they can play. You know, if it's busy and the public's there, it's, you know, common courtesy that you would step aside and let somebody, the paying public.
What do they do at Cleary Lake?
So the park district has a recreation pass, and so they're allowed to have like a downhill ski pass, an annual pass, or a golf, but they don't give golf passes out. They just let them golf during certain times when it's, you know, the non-peak time. And, you know, then they have their smaller passes, the dog park passes or the boat rental or the boat passes and stuff like that.
When you say passes, it's free to the employees?
Part of our wellness program, or it's part of our incentive for a program. And you really, the superintendent signs off on it every year. You sign up for it. Your family members can be included in it. And then they are entitled to a recreation pass. And the recreation pass would include those maybe six. So it could be something where if we chose to do more of a pass like that, where maybe we'd include the pool, because not everybody is a golfer and not everybody's family is there, but you could do it where you would allow families to utilize the pool too. Those are the two amenities that I think that the city has that's really not going to cost us anything by allowing somebody to.
Mike, is there any insurance benefit that we could get or discount if we came up and developed a wellness plan that we might be able to save?
Well, we have through the Blue Cross Blue Shield program right now that they have access to different various workout facilities, and as long as you use it 12 times a month, like most employees, that you get $20 per person, up to two people, I think, off the price of the cost of that membership. Adding one thing back on what Jenna was talking about that we talked about is we have to be careful on what we provide, that if it is the value of a membership, that there were some issues that we ran into from an auditing standpoint that we got to make sure that, you know, we'd probably end up having to do a 1099 on that that would have to go back to the employee that we weren't doing. And so we need to be careful of how we structure and or deal with that part of it.
Does Three Rivers do that, Jenna? Do you get a 1099 for the value of the...
Not that we don't. And I'm not sure because it's under a recreation pass, because you're not getting every value. You know, you just have access to those.
Okay.
So if you want them, you can have them. You just go through the front desk and while they're doing them. And I'm wondering if, because we're not getting a $800 or a certain value, it's more of
Well, the $600 is the threshold.
Is that what it is?
Okay. It is.
Oh, sure.
You know, so anything above $600, and that's where we kind of ran into this problem before, is a member, single membership was above that threshold, but we weren't reporting it per se. And so that's where my concern was, and that's kind of how we went down the path we did, is because, you know, we didn't want to have the IRS come knocking on our door and say, you know, these people have been getting a free membership, you know, and then they get audited and all of a sudden they have to pay tax on it, and they're like, well, what the heck? I didn't know, if I'd have known that, type of thing, you know. So that's how, you know, we kind of went with it. But now, do you just do that with full-time employees?
You're full-time and part-time non-benefited. And so they would be entitled to the recreation pass. You know, again, we have 400 employees at the parks, and not everybody can sign up for it, but I don't know that a lot of them use them. Some have different interests. Some might be a dog walker. Some might be a downhill skier with their family. But it's a way to get the staff out into the facilities too, to learn about it. It educates them. It helps them answer questions better. It helps them feel valued in the organization that they get to. The headquarters people like to get out into the field and be able to participate in the activities that a lot of times they're behind a desk talking about, but they don't ever get to experience it, and they do it on their own time then. So.
Okay. Any other comments?
I think it's it's a nice thing to do. I have a couple reservations with it. One is the tax angle, like Chuck mentioned. The other one is we just disallowed this just over a year ago, and to go back and institute it now, I guess, would tell me as a resident, council doesn't know what the hell they're doing to change something all of a sudden because somebody says, well, we're doing it that way this place. Maybe we should change our mind and do it now in New Prague. So I have reservations about doing it. That's just my personal opinion.
Would you feel better about it if it was more of a wellness plan or that, or just because it's golf?
Mostly
just because
golf.
You're changing on the whole idea.
I guess my take on it is I don't, you know, I know what we did before, but I kind of look at it, you know, even if we had a special rate for people, you know, and if it's half of a membership or, you know, a reduced rate if you're a city employee, you know, then that way you're not giving them anything, you're just giving them a reduced rate. It's like anything else here, you got resident rate and non-resident rate and things like that based on the city, you know, if you lived in the city or not. But, you know, that would be my take. You know, it's the golf course. I agree with you. The golf course is there. You know, it's, if you have one person playing or if you have 1,000 people playing on it, the maintenance costs are still, you still got to cut the greens and still got to cut the fairways and everything. So your cost is a fixed cost to operate it. And obviously the more people you get out to use it, you would hope that those people then would maybe go and have a cocktail and a burger or something like that, and then you're making money on that side of the business, you know, which is more of an indirect cost. You know, I would like to, you know, and again, this is not something we have to decide today or anything. I would like to look at some kind of a maybe reduced green fee or a special employee card that they come in and, you know, if they have an employee card or, you know, or employee number or something they have to give, they get a reduced green fee rate for the people who only want to play once or twice a year. And the ones who want to be a member per se or want to play more, you know, you say, okay, here you can even make it like a 10-round pass or something like that. at a reduced rate. You know, then that way, you know, they are paying for, you know, the people who are playing golf there, if they're not going to play at New Prague, they're probably going to play at Creeks Bend or going to play at Montgomery or something. So they, you know, they are going to, you know, pay for the golf. But that's just my opinion.
As I mentioned at the beginning, is that I just got that public listing of all the public courses that the State Auditor's Office have, is that we can have somebody do an inquiry to a number of those and find out what, if anything, is provided, you know, by checking into some of that, if you think that might be helpful, just to give you some idea, and that A or nay or here's what it is, so at least you've got some way to gauge if they're doing something at their own city courses as well. That's one possibility.
My understanding right now is even the staff that works at the golf course, the part-time seasonals, nobody can play that golf course without paying for it.
Correct.
Yeah, and that seems just really different way to approach it, because, again, if you're the person behind that front counter and you're supposed to be engaging with the customer and yet you're making $9 an hour to be behind the counter and you're, I mean, how do you talk golf course to them without knowing how to play the course and knowing, being someone that works on the golf course, I don't play a lot of times on the golf course because I'm ready to go home when it's there. But I just still think it's a, there's a value to the city, I think, to our staff and to even our golf staff, to be able to let them play that golf course at a substantial reduced rate or even free as part of their employment to it. So that's my feeling. I think there's benefits to the city besides just to the wellness of the employee.
But to your point, you know, my daughter worked in the pro shop, and I told her, I says, you know, if you want to go play, I mean, just charge it to my account. And she could use my card and everything. She says, after being there 8 hours and that stuff, that's the last thing I want to do is be at the golf course. You know, to your point, you know, so, you know, you made the statement, and that's just it. I mean, you know, there's some people who, you know, after working, you know, maybe want to go play. But then there's, you know, a lot of people are like, okay, I'm done with it because, you know, I've had to deal with headaches of some guy complaining that, oh, the course sucked or something like that or something like that. And that's the last thing. I want to get away from there. So, but, no, I agree with you. I think I would like to, you know, continue on this discussion. I think, Mike, maybe if we can get a couple flavor of how some other public courses do.
I can at least try to and see what I get from that and just see what others are doing.
Yeah.
Would the council be in favor of at least exploring what cities or other agencies do with their other, like if they have a swim pool or like, you know, like St. Louis Park has a big swimming area. Would you be interested in knowing that, how they relate their other amenities into some kind of a recreation pass for their staff? Because, you know, the golf course is a golf course, but some people come with small kids or they have younger families that they're not ever going to utilize the golf course because it's not fitting their lifestyle right now, but the pool might be. Is that of interest of anybody to see how they other cities handle their...
Yeah, I would think that would be a good interest. I don't know how, you know, once the indoor pool, I mean, how's that, you know, with the joint powers agreement, I suppose that has to be determine if they're going to, you know, have memberships for citizens and things like that. I don't.
That will take us obviously a little bit more work because it's not like I can go to a book and it tells me just exactly besides golf or an indoor-outdoor pool what other ancillary services that they have. So that would really be a cold call, hit and miss attempt to try to get that, and then to get to the right person as to what you're doing for the city. That. That would take a little bit more work and time to get that accomplished.
Put a lot of pressure on the school district, too, which has many, many more employees that the city that only had a tenth of the initial investment in the pool gets to utilize the pool, or they're where the school district employees might not, or even if they did, there'd be a lot more that would probably...
Well, obviously, in that issue, you've got a choice whether you bifurcate... the council making the decision with the outdoor pool versus whether you do that with the indoor pool or not.
Sure, sure. I'd be interested if Jenna could, you have a golf board meeting tomorrow night, right, as the council rep? I'd like to know what the advisory board or the golf board thinks, if you could bring that up at tomorrow's meeting as well. So
I just have a hard time. I I have a hard time as a city employee somewhere else, and for other city employees, they're very appreciative, appreciate all the city employees, but I have a hard time saying that they should get extra privileges than another resident. To me, that's not fair to the other residents.
Well, why don't we, you know, if everyone's okay, why don't we just kind of get some feedback from other facilities?
We'll make an attempt and start with the golf.
Let's just look at that. And then
maybe a little bit separate from that, but at least I know how to go about. We can get the pool or the.
Sean brought up a good point that, you know, if you start messing with the indoor pool thing, you know, how is the school district? They might not like it on your joint powers agreement. Hey, you can't give that stuff away because now, you know. Like Sean's point, they got 400 teachers and that stuff. Well, why don't I get a thing? So, okay. If that's all right with everyone, to get some more additional information and move forward. Okay. Well, thank you, Mike. So are we done for the night? Oh, next on the agenda, after two fatal, feeble attempts of not showing up on us, but
three, wasn't it?
No, this would have been third. Said third, and he'd been striked out. I'd like to introduce Mark Bartusek, fellow council member of the City of New Prague. He would like to introduce his new adventure.
Does that work?
Yeah.
All right. I didn't ditch you on purpose. I overscheduled one night, and I was at a Sewer County BPOU meeting last meeting when you called me. I think I was sitting there.
Sounds like a politician already.
I hope not. That's actually my goal, is to not sound like a politician. Everybody knows me here, so I don't have to go through that. I am seeking the endorsement for the Republican nomination for the District 20 Senate seat, which would... if I would get the endorsement April 11th, I will run against Kevin Dahl from Northfield. I decided to run probably about a month and a half after I moved out of the city. Someone that I came in contact with to explore the opportunity actually was going to ask me to run anyway, so it was kind of bizarre. But that's the way things work sometimes. I guess the reason I came here, just to formally tell you that I am running, once I get the endorsement, I guess I'd hopefully will have your support. And I know when I scheduled a meeting with Montgomery, Mike already helped me because he got a call from the city administrator in Montgomery. And he must have said something nice about me because I got an email back from Gene Keogh within a day that said I can come anytime. So that was nice. I didn't even have to pay him to do that. So, and the other thing I was going to say was what was really interesting for me, I guess, so far, I visited, I think this is the seventh city I've been to, and I visited with four out of, I think there's six school districts in District 20. After Wednesday, I will have met with all of them except for Cleveland. And I still want to get to Cleveland, but I want to meet with all the school districts and cities in this district. And it's been fun visiting with the cities, I guess. I don't know what you guys are thinking right now, but I've gotten a lot of questions about how I feel about LGA. For some reason, a lot of small towns are worried about that. Is there any threat this year for LGA?
No, it doesn't appear to be at this point.
Okay. Well, anyway, that's a real popular question with smaller towns, smaller than us, I guess. I haven't been to Northfield yet. That'll be tomorrow. But one of the reasons that I'm doing that, I guess, is that I want to that's going to be my priority, is to interact with cities and school districts and the public in general versus what we have now for representation from the state. Maybe not with Bob Vogel. I think he gets out a little bit more, although I don't know because I wasn't in his district until I just moved out of the city. But I know that our representation from Northfield right now, and I've gotten the same feeling from all the cities I've been to, a lot of times people ask me who our senator is because they don't even know, because they never hear from him, never see him, except for his, I think twice a year he goes from town to town for, gives everybody a whole half an hour to sit down and visit with him. And that is not my idea of good representation, I guess. But it has been interesting when I started to run, in that they make you pick a team per se right away, whether they're going to be a Republican or a Democrat. And I've done my best to not talk about either one of them, and that's my goal, because I think that's why things aren't getting done right now, is because right away they get the first thing that comes up in a discussion or what are you, not who you are. So that's what I'm focusing my campaign on, and it's been, I've been received pretty well, I guess, so far. I think we need to get to the problem and solve that and not worry about who somebody's voted for the last three times or what party or affiliate. I mean, it really shouldn't matter in my mind, I guess. And until people start to look past that, I don't think we're going to solve many problems. So that's about all I had to say. I can answer any questions you have, or you can not ask any and get out of here sooner. Sean, how many do you have?
I can't think of a one right now.
Do you have someone else also running for the Republican endorsement?
There's three other people.
Three other people? Okay.
Running right now. There's a guy from Bruce Moreland from Northfield, Bridgewater Township. He's an older retired guy. He was in the service and worked for the Mayo Clinic. Younger guy from Shieldsville Township, I believe, is where he's. Could be Bridgewater, but it's in that Shieldsville area, Danny Petrichka. And there is a Rich Draheim from the Lake Washington area, way down in I think he's about 2 or 3 miles from being out of the district, honestly. I'm not 100% sure. I guess I feel that that's one strength of mine, is that I've lived in the center of this district almost my entire life. I've done business in all the cities that are represented. I know people in all the cities. I think that should be an important piece of it, but I guess we'll find out.
So there's a primary on April 11th?
It's an endorsing convention. It's not a primary.
Okay, so it's kind of like a caucus type deal?
Yeah, at every caucus they elect or appoint or people. Every caucus did it differently. Delegates go from their caucus to the endorsing convention in Montgomery, and then they have, I've never been to one, I guess, I'm not sure what other business is there, but there'll be two candidates that are running for 20B, which is Rice County and four eastern townships in Le Sueur County. David Bly is the representative there. There's two people that want to get endorsed, two people that are seeking endorsement for that, and then there's four people for the Senate, and they'll go through and vote at that time.
Yeah.
Dang it, I thought it was something else. I can't remember what it was.
Any other questions for Mark? Well,
should we ask him what his position is on LGA and how he would represent the city in the process?
I think we need to give it to the other towns in the district more than New Prague.
Well, thanks.
Hopefully it'll stay the same, I guess. I don't know how the state goes about dispersing it. But I won't handcuff you, Mike. You'll be okay. We had to run with a shortfall long enough.
battled it, managed it fairly well.
Well, good luck.
Well, yes, thanks for coming in and introducing your position and answering questions, and best of luck.
Thanks.
Next on the agenda is the consent agenda, with taking out the one letter E, which we'll address after the consent agenda. So does anyone have any questions or comments or issues on any items in the consent agenda?
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
I got a motion by Dave Brugic, second by Amy Jurek, to approve the consent agenda. Is there any other questions or comments? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Okay, passes 5-0. Now, Mike, what would you like to do with the JTs?
For the council's benefit, I asked the mayor to see if we could pull it just for separate discussion, because as you can see in here, there's a number of items that are not completed by the applicant, but this is our last council meeting before April 1st, which is when the new liquor licenses go into effect. As you can see, the fee has been paid, but we do not have the liquor liability insurance, which we normally have before we bring it to you, but in this case we still do not. The payment of the liquor fine has not occurred as of the present time. And then lastly, there was a piece that I thought was going to have been taken care of on Friday, that there's a late payment on a utility fee amounting to $56.11. So I would need to add that to the additional recommendation that I'm asking for your approval with a contingency that these items, the payment of the liquor fine, the providing proof of liquor liability insurance, and also the late utility payment be taken care of before we submit the applicant's application to the state of Minnesota.
Okay. Any questions?
They haven't made contact with the city.
Yes, there has been lots of contact, just non-delivery of all of the elements necessary to take care of those contingencies. And so because we have no meetings between now and April 1, if those don't get resolved, I'm not able to send it into the state, and thus they would come to April 1 without a liquor license for the start of the new liquor liability, the new liquor year.
If they don't, obviously they cannot operate.
Correct.
After April 1st.
At midnight on March 31st.
But would they be able to then, I mean, if the middle of the month, if they came up with everything, do you have to, I mean, could we then apply for a liquor license at that time?
Well, if you take the action right now that once these elements are complied with, I can submit it to the state.
At any time?
At any time.
Okay. That was my question. I just didn't know if, you know, if they missed April 1st, did they have to wait 30 days?
No, it's only from the standpoint if they want to be ready to go when their current license expires.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions?
I'll make a motion to approve Mike sending in the license once the two contingencies have been met.
Three contingencies.
Three contingencies.
Okay. I'll second that. So we have a motion by Amy Jurek to approve JT's liquor license with the three contingencies have been met, and second by Chuck Nicolai. Any other questions? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Okay, passes 5-0. Miscellaneous. Where's Jim? Oh.
Another night off.
Glenn, do you have anything?
No, just the lights are going good at the baseball field. It started out kind of soft there, but it's firmed up quite a bit. In fact, they just got one more tower, a few lights to finish on one tower and then finish the last tower. The two that are going to be moved and replaced, we're not putting new lights on those. So it's gone pretty good. It started a little rocky or a little shaky, but it's gone pretty good. I think the field looks really good. So if you have a chance to walk out there, walk out there. I think the top dressing has proved to improve it quite a bit. So pretty happy to see that. That's all I got.
When are they going to test those lights? I'm out of town.
I don't know the answer to that. I forgot to call Kenny because I was going to, when I leave here, go throw the lights on, and then I thought, that might be a mistake without checking with him if there's something not hooked up. So I'll let you know, though, when they plan on doing that.
Yeah, I'd like to see that because I think that's going to, hopefully, I mean, with the shields and everything, actually, if it directs it more, it may, you know.
They claim you're going to see a huge difference.
Yeah. I'm just wondering about the people across from the field.
If you see that there are shields.
Right, that's what I'm saying. I'm hoping the shields actually direct it on the field and it doesn't create any.
Well, we have a specific lighting plan that is directed to certain spots on the field that those lights are directed to hit to provide cross coverage throughout the entire baseball field. So it's a fairly sophisticated lighting plan.
Oh, yeah. Most definitely, but we've thought of the same thing.
Yeah.
Doubling the lighting powers is going to be a lot brighter in the neighborhood. We hope not.
Yeah.
Well, it'll probably be somewhat the same feeling as when you come down Central Avenue when we switch from the old orange sodium vapor lights to the new lights that we have
LED,
here,
yeah.
Where we had people wondering whether we were trying to land planes on the runway or something. And so,
yeah, eventually they get used to it, but I'm sure that first few times there might be
a little brighter
few phone
than
calls.
Yep. So that's all I got. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Ken?
I don't have anything.
Come on, Ken.
Maybe next time.
Okay. Chris, you got anything else? Patrick? Photo, okay. Well, you were here, you were kind of late.
And as you saw, Patrick was given the opportunity to go up and experience what 80 feet above the ground feels like with doing the lighting story for us. So we gave him that experience.
I stopped by and talked to him, and they asked if I wanted to go up. And I said, you know, I feel I'm 6'5", and I can see everything I need to see from the ground. But Mary Jo.
I do.
Yes, all right. Mark it on your calendars. Mary Jo's taking over.
The board and commission packet is she's showing that April 11th they're due, and then when you want to do interviews.
Okay. So when are they going out for? And then have they been published yet?
They have been published.
Okay.
And April 11th they're due.
Okay. So once you get the number, then we'll just have to pick up, you know, I think we've done it before council meetings in the past. You know, we try to set them up, you know, that hour before a council meeting to do the interviews.
So should we just pencil it on the 18th to start earlier? Well, too early? The 18th?
Yeah. Yeah, well, let's pencil in the 18th that we'll start. Hopefully we'll have applicants, and we won't have to beg, borrow, and steal, but I hope. We do have some people, so. Okay. Anything else? How was Houston? Okay. Mike? Sean?
Yes, I have something. and I think all of you are aware of it, but we'll discuss it. If we could, the idea of switching our council meetings to 6 p.m. as opposed to 7 at least on a trial basis. I know it kind of came about when Mike and Ken and I were meeting with the during the joint powers meeting at 5 o'clock with the superintendent and personnel from the school district, and to get out an hour early was pretty nice. It still allowed for plenty of time to do some stuff at home with the daylight out, and I made a comment to Mike in passing as we were walking out from that meeting, and he said to bring it up in front of the board. I think he's talked to a couple of you guys. If it doesn't create an issue with work schedules and whatnot, I think it might be kind of nice to try it. Mike, you said some of your former cities moved theirs up and had no
city
problem.
The one I just came from, that we didn't start till 7:30 at night, and they moved it to 5:30, and after the trial period they wouldn't even talk about going back. So they liked, once they moved to the earlier time slot, it just got them out earlier, especially in the summer. But even during the winter, it was nice not to come in to have to be here so late at night, part of the process. And so if we've got a short agenda at 45 minutes to an hour, that people are in and out much quicker and still have the rest of the evening left. And so staff wholeheartedly would support whatever you want to try for a trial basis. You know, whether you started here beginning in April, or whether you start it in May and maybe do the summer and then evaluate it at the end of the summer.
What's everyone's
ball?
Doesn't mean the meetings are going to go any longer, though, than they typically would have, right? So we're not always just going to get out at 9, no matter what.
No.
Just kidding.
Well, it depends, you know?
I'm in favor of it. It works with my schedule.
Oh, you, Amy?
I'm in favor, but maybe if we could do it as a trial to see if that is the best time, if it meets the residents' needs, too.
Okay, well, yes. David?
Yeah, I'm in favor of it.
Okay. I'd like to maybe start in May just because of different calendar stuff already in April, but at least maybe through the summer, May through August or September,
yeah,
and reevaluate it.
And if we think that works for everyone,
great
then
idea.
We can continue. Does that work for you, Mike?
Just fine. So May through August. Why don't you take that a forefront in action then? So we've got that on the.
I'll make a proposal that we change the city council meetings from 7 o'clock till 6 o'clock. On a trial basis from May through August, and then reevaluate in September.
Could we change that to go through September just so we meet a little more of the school schedule?
Sure, absolutely.
Just,
we can change
conflict.
It from May through September.
Okay. I got it.
You may want to, I'll wait till you get a second.
I'll second it.
Second by Jenna Tuma.
May want to take a look at that in deciding in September before we get done, because if we wait till after September is over, then we're caught in a quandary. Are we back to the old time or stay at the new time? So you may want to put that at the last meeting in September. We evaluate that.
Okay.
If
yeah, that would be fine. Way more difficult than I thought.
Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? Okay. Good. That'll be something exciting. We're just getting thinking outside the box here. Sean, you have anything else?
That is it.
David?
Nothing.
Jenna?
I'm good.
Amy?
No, I have nothing.
Okay. I do not have anything. So I guess I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Second by Dave Brusick. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Okay, it's photo time. We can't have Jenna
the
in the flag, okay?